Thank you for rejoining us. Walid, tell us the impact of the Six-Day War on your life. I know that the Arab media was announcing that the Arab armies had driven the Jews out of Jerusalem, when in fact, Jewish tanks were on the outskirts of Cairo, Egypt, and rumbling down the streets of Jordan. Tell us the impact of the Six-Day War on your life.
I recall when the media was saying, we cleansed Jerusalem from all the Jews after the battle was over. We opened the doors and we saw the Israeli tanks with the Star of David. And I remember asking my father,
on the streets,
they have already gotten to Jerusalem and even got all the way to Jericho. And I asked my father, I said, this is not the flag we salute. And he said, we've lost the war. Of course, my mother was very happy because she was still a Christian. She still had faith. And my father asked her, why are you so happy? And she says, well, we took this in Sunday school, that this will happen. In fact, Psalm 83 is very clear. Joshua had a six-day war as well. Mm-hmm. Because if you look at the text, it says, on the seventh day, early in the morning, the children of Israel went around the walls of Jericho seven times, and the walls fell down.
Wonderful.
So we've lived, all of us, a parallel to Joshua's war. We as Christians, sometimes we think, well, you know, God speaks to us personally. Well, he does, but he speaks to the whole world as well. This was a message from God to the whole world, that he's established Jerusalem as his capital, as the capital for Israel. Yet we didn't see this as Muslims. But when I read Psalm 83, it astonished me. When I read Amos chapter 9, verse 15, and I will plant them in their land, and no longer shall they be pulled out of that land. We tried in Yom Kippur. We tried in the Six Days War. We tried many wars. We never succeeded because of that single promise that God gave in the book of Amos.
Yes. Now, I would like for you to share with our audience the role of the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem in bringing Hitler's hatred of the Jews to the Arab Islamics. Many Americans cannot connect that dot. But the fact is, the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem was, in fact, the chief spiritual leader, if you will, of the Arab people, and that he was received by Hitler in Berlin and received by Goebbels, the minister of propaganda. And many of the things that Hitler did with his Nazis, the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem did, in fact, take it back and give it to the Arab people, the Islamic people, to use against the Jews.
Yes.
Now, what are the similarities that Hitler brought to the Grand Mufti that have followed in Islam from that point until now?
What Americans need to understand is the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem. He was a good friend of my grandfather.
He was a friend of your grandfather.
He used to come visit our home. He gets his sources from the Umar Covenant, the Umar Declaration. Umar ibn al-Khattab was the second caliph in Islam. He was a friend of Muhammad the Prophet.
Yes.
That's where the source comes from. We have to put that in perspective.
So he's connected.
Yes, so it's not just some offshoot of Islam here. This guy just on his own whimsical interpretation.
He was the Pope. Would that be too strong?
Well, he would be the Muslim Supreme Council of the Palestinian areas over there. Umar declaration is very clear. The second caliph in Islam, one of the 10 promised to go to paradise in Islam, Umar clearly says that Jews must put yellow patches on their right shoulder. Most Americans don't know that the yellow patch on the Jewish right shoulder in Nazi Germany did not come from Nazi Germany. It came as an adoption from Spain because the Muslims ruled Spain. And if you compare the edicts that was issued by Umar ibn al-Khattab, which Hajj Amin al-Husseini also taught the Nazis, you find them to be almost exact. Jews must never enter into a Muslim bathhouse in the Umar declaration. Jews must never enter into a German restaurant. Jews must never be a judge over Muslims. Jews must never be a judge over Germans. Jews must pay double the taxation in Nazi Germany. Jews must pay the jizya in accordance to the Quran. حتى يدفعوا الجزية عن يدهم وهم صغيرون, that they pay the taxation by an upper hand, may they be belittled. This is from the Quran itself. Mm-hmm. So Hajj Amin al-Husseini collaborated on the eve of the final solution. You should see his picture right there with Hitler. Most Americans do not know that the Nazi war machine was composed of 8 different Nazi divisions, 2 of which were Muslim fundamentalists. The Khanzar division, Bosnian, the Albanian division, they destroyed 90% of the Jewish people in Bosnia. They destroyed thousands of churches. Hajj Amin al-Husseini was called the Führer of the Arab world by Hitler.
Wow.
Yes, that was his nickname. He was the Führer of the Arab world. His job was to destroy the Jews in the Muslim world. In fact, 850,000 Jews ended up running away from the Muslim world, going to no place but Israel, of course, and the Palestinians claim, and the world claim, the Arabs had nothing to do with the Holocaust. Indeed, they did. He was there in the ovens in Auschwitz, enticing the Germans to speed up the work. he had a huge role. Yet the Holocaust museums don't portray him as a Hitler because it's a sympathy by the Jewish community towards the Muslims, so they don't want to make some embarrassments.
Well, it's a very real historical connection, and it helps Americans understand the demonic hatred that exists for the Jewish people. Hitler had it. The people of America clearly understand that. They don't really have the ability to compute how a people, the radical Islams, the terrorists, can believe that they have a command from God to kill Christians and Jews. But when you begin to connect the dots, that systemic hatred, that pathological hatred, that profound paranoia was there that drove them in this compulsion against the Jewish people.
From the mid-30s, from 1936 on, Hitler and his propaganda sections made a great effort to win over the Arab peoples of the Middle East.
We see that the undisputed leader of the Palestinian Arab national movement of the 1920s, 1930s and 40s, Haji Amin al-Husseini, the Mufti of Jerusalem, was a fervent admirer of Adolf Hitler.
The Mufti was one of the founders of the radical Islamic movement, and Hitler saw at once that this man not only could serve his purpose, but wanted to serve his purpose.
There is a very important meeting between Hitler and the Mufti of Jerusalem on the 28th of November 1941, of which we have a full protocol. And what Hitler explains is that this is first and foremost a war of extermination against Jewry. And he tells him to lock this secret in his heart. He is revealing it to the Mufti. It's extraordinary he should choose the leader of the Palestinian Arab National Movement for this revelation, which isn't an official German document.
It seemed strange to us that a Mufti who was not a pure Aryan was being received by Hitler. But they said, no, we have the same goal, which is the extermination of the Jews.
The Mufti was sent to the Balkans, where he raised a Bosnian Muslim SS division.
He had several SS divisions, the Handschar division, for example, where they had nominally Croatian officers, but the rank and file of the unit were entirely Muslim, Arab Muslims, and they were bringing them in from all over the world.
I was utterly astonished that the Grand Mufti of Jerusalem had raised a Panzer division of Bosnian Muslims to fight along the Waffen-SS. The fanatic Muslim world and Hitler both agreed that no ideology can exist beyond theirs. It's all-encompassing.
A secular dogma like Nazism is less dangerous than this Islamofascism that we see today. It's less dangerous because Islamofascism has a religious twist to it. It says God the Almighty ordered you to do this, not the Führer, you know. So it is way more dangerous. It's trying to grow itself in 55 Muslim states, so potentially you could have a success rate of several Nazi Germanys if these people get their way.
Islam is presented in many of the American media outlets as being peaceful, but yet the actions of the people are so very violent. Tell us, tell our audience the extreme hatred that you have seen, not read about, but things you have seen demonstrated by Islamics against the Jewish people.
I remember when I was doing my research, Pastor, going to Hebron even, I saw a bus being stoned by the Palestinians with bars and wire mesh. And I asked myself, this was after I left to the States, I asked myself, why are the Jews not allowed to live amongst us? I remember myself even nearly lynching an Israeli soldier. My friend was pounding a nail on his head. You see in Ramallah Square, in the capital of, quote, Palestine, that the Americans helped create and the world helped create. You see thousands and thousands of men in the square of Ramallah carrying body parts of a so-called collaborator, somebody maybe was sympathizing with Israel. They took his guts out, his heart, his kidney, and put it in a platter. And you see the men and the children carrying the body parts, praising Allahu Akbar in a frenzy fashion, in a euphoric fashion. And the videotape clearly shows it. My country, Pastor, has become the night of the living dead, literally. Not allegorically. What we accuse the Jews of, the blood libel, the Dracula, will supposedly Sharon manufactures Arab blood so he can feed it, give it to the rabbis. What we accuse the Jews of, we carried out literally. If you think in reverse, what they accuse America of, these enemies, they carry out literally.
That's what they're literally doing.
That's right.
Yeah, we're also told that there are moderate Muslims. And if there are so many moderate Muslims, it's presented this way, that the radical Islamics who kill Christians and Jews are a small group of people, and the preponderance, the majority of the Islamics are moderate people. But the question is, where is the voice of the moderate people? I can understand why the people in Saudi Arabia don't speak up, because they would be beheaded. But what about those in America who are supposed to be moderate? They can do what they wish in this country. They can burn the flag of the United States in Washington, D.C. With all of that freedom, why don't they speak up?
Well, what Americans don't understand is that Islam is not simply a mere religion. Islam is civil code and a government that to be established throughout the whole world. It is a system of government with civil code. So let's ask an American and say, well, would the Northern Alliance of Afghanistan be moderate? Well, they would say, yes, they supported the United States against the Taliban. So who are the fundamentalists? Well, you would say the Taliban is the fundamentalist. However, when an Afghan converted to Christianity, it doesn't matter whether the person is moderate, whether he is pro-Northern Alliance, or whether the Afghan is pro-Taliban. Everybody wanted this convert dead. So we must understand there's a distinction here. What we consider moderate, what we consider fundamentalist. Even the moderate Muslims adhere to the civil code of Islam, Sharia. So there are liberal Muslims, however, who are mostly Iranian Americans. These are not peaceful Muslims because of Islam. They're peaceful despite of Islam. I know a gentleman by the name Tashbih Sayyid, wonderful guy, claims to be a Muslim. And he speaks, and he's pro-Israel and everything else. My partner and best friend, Mohammed, he's from Afghanistan. He's a wonderful guy. He reads the Quran. He prays five times a day. Nevertheless, when I quote to him the Quran or I quote him the Hadith, he says, well, Muhammad never said that. So in other words, they have their own concoction of what Islam is.
They are a group of people that have different interpretations to their own Bible predicated on the situation in which they find themselves.
Yes.
I want you to join us again tomorrow. Walid is going to be with us. You need to hear this. It's the truth, and it's good for you to know.
I was a terrorist. I planted a bomb in the bank. I wanted to kill Jews. I hated them. I read the Bible in 1993 and spent a year researching it because my wife asked me, where are the corruptions in the Bible? I was going to convert her to Islam. The truth in the Bible is the best investment any man can make. And thank God I got out of Islam, Pastor.
Walid Shoebat is an ex-Muslim terrorist. His conversion to Christianity is a powerful testimony everyone should hear. As a companion resource, we also want you to have the documentary Obsession, Radical Islam's War Against the West. Obsession reveals the unbridled hatred radical Islam has for Western civilization. Pastor's interview with Walid Shoebat is available on cassette, CD, and VHS or DVD. The movie Obsession is available only on DVD. Call 1-800-854-9899. Ask for offer number KT127.
I want to introduce to you the most urgent and important sermon series I have ever preached. World War III has begun. In this sermon, I describe the religious war that threatens the future of America. President Bush has said this nation is at war with Islamofascism. It is life or death. We want to live, and the Islamofascists want to die in a holy war.
When did this war start? In the sermon, I say why we were attacked. Can we lose this war? What does losing this war mean to you and to America? The second sermon is From Abraham to Armageddon. In the third sermon, I talk about the judgment of the nations. I want you to get this series and let your family, your friends, and church members hear it. It's a wake-up call for America.
To order Pastor John Hagee's sermon series, World War III has begun. Call and ask for offer S0634. All three sermons are available on audio cassette, CD, and VHS or DVD.
Thank you for joining the telecast. We're delighted to have Walid with us today. And Walid, thank you for coming.
Honor.
It's a pleasure to have you. Your story is very gripping. It's very, very important for America to hear it because it's something that you have lived.
Yes, sir.
It's not something that you read in a book. This is something that is part and parcel of your life. One of the questions I would like to ask you is, what percentage of Islamics are committed to killing Christians and Jews?
What's the percentage of Muslims that adhere to Islamic fanaticism or the fundamentalist Islam, what Americans, as they understand it? Many times you hear scholars saying it's 15%, and I caught myself even saying this in the secular media. And even some of the scholars who I confronted, I asked them, is it really 15? They say, no, it's not. But because it's so tremendously more, it will be too overwhelming, and the media won't even accept the numbers. Al-Arabiya Network, which is an Arab survey done by Arabs themselves, when the elections were happening in the Palestinian areas, the question was, would you want Hamas or would you want the PA, the Palestinian Authority, to be the representative of the Palestinian people? 113,000 were surveyed. From all perspectives of the Middle East, the Arab world, were asked that question. Over 73% said we want Hamas to represent the Palestinians. In essence, what they're saying, we want Al-Qaeda-like system government in the Palestinian areas. This is what the Arab world is. We can say over 73% of the Arab world support jihad ideology, supported by giving zakah, giving the alms, supported by finances, supported by political means, or supported by giving their bodies. So an old person can send money, funding towards jihad, and is doing jihad himself. So all this money is being funneled from Saudi Arabia, billions of dollars going right into building madrasas in the U.S., in London, all over the place. The American Muslim Society, it gets its funding from Saudi Arabia. So it's very clear what they're doing.
It's very clear. We've heard it so many times from many Muslim leaders that they want to Islamize the world.
Ayam inqilab, ayam jahanist, dar jughrafia va zaman mahdood nemi shavad. Tardid nakonid ke inshallah Islam hame kujah ro fath khahad kard. Hame qulle haye jahan ro fath khahad kard.
قد حكمنا الدنيا وسيأتي يوم والله نحكم فيه كل الدنيا سيأتي يوم نحكم فيه أمريكا سيأتي يوم نحكم فيه بريطانيا ونحكم فيه كل العالم.
Radical Islamic groups want to see the world unified under Islam.
It's only a matter of time until we rule Earth, until we control Earth.
One day this very flag will fly over the parliament in London. We will see this flag that will fly over the White House. And we will see the Black House, the Kaaba, will take over the whole world.
Islam to the world.
You will take over USA. You will take over UK. You will take over Europe. You will defeat them all. You will get victory. You will take over Egypt. We trust in Allah.
Indeed, there is me who sent his messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the deen of Haq, with Islam, to dominate all of our other religions, to dominate the United States, to dominate the world, even though the non-Muslims may hate it.
I read an article the other day that said there are 1.3 billion people on the face of the earth practicing Islam. Now, if 70% of 1.3 billion want to have jihad, which is holy war, and want to execute Christians and Jews, you're talking about somewhere in the neighborhood of 800 million people on the face of the earth that want to do that. Would you say that's an accurate number?
Yes, either you can say it depends on what you understand. They support the ideology. Yes, it would be 800 million that would support the ideology, between supporting, funding, and morally supporting and wanting to carry out jihad themselves from the youth. That would be a correct number, yes. And remember, for many years you've been saying 15%. That is not accurate. It's almost over 73%.
Well, even if it were 15%, 15% of 1.3 billion people is still 200 million. Hitler didn't have an army near that big.
Yes,
all of the Axis powers were not that big.
Yes.
But here, this is not an army that's centralized. This is an army that is here. They're living next door. They're ready to respond to a phone call. And 15 of them with bombs in the right places can with a nuclear suitcase bomb, can bring a city down.
Yeah, we've seen 10 airplanes almost got hijacked. It is very alarming. America needs to wake up. We could potentially have not just one Nazi Germany. We could have 20 Nazi Germanies if they topple the governments. You look at a country like Turkey, it's very sensitive. An Islamist government won the elections.
Yes.
Erdogan's wife dresses in the Sharia garb to say that we want to reverse what Kemal Atatürk did,
yes,
which is modernize Turkey.
Yes.
And they want to enter into the EU. They want to, get all the Muslims all throughout the EU and water down the EU with Islamic fundamentalism. You got a country like Pakistan. The majority of Pakistanis want a Muslim fundamentalist government. The situation with Musharraf, if he is ousted, guess what? They already have nuclear. We don't have to worry about the nuclear. They have it.
Yes.
And you have Iran. We're seeing Iran. Iran potentially is taking over Iraq. The government in Iraq is Shia government. It's very clear. The writing is on the wall. Iraq now is Iran's baby. And with Syria, Alawite government, also pro-Shia revolution. You have in Lebanon, Hezbollah. That's a whole different topic of what's going on in Hezbollah. It's a government within itself taking over Lebanon, which was a Christian country.
If you take a map and look across Europe and look across the Middle East, it is becoming Islamic. That's why they are attacking Israel. If Israel falls, the fortress of freedom in the Middle East is gone. Then look at Venezuela and their leader, who's anti-American, and anything that fights America, that ideology is coming up through Mexico. America is being encircled by this ideology, and the Islamics, if the war lasts 50 years, that's fine. They're very patient and very determined to reach that goal. There is a statement that I have been reading, and I would like for you to explain it to our people. Is what is the meaning of first the Saturday people and then the Sunday people? Tell us that meaning.
Well, it depends. In Iran, it's first the Sunday people, then the Saturday people. Ahmadinejad has an hourglass behind him, but his two balls, marbles, are coming down. The first one is America being crushed, falls down, and then it is the Morgan David. You can see in Iran hundreds of thousands of soldiers marching in the street, being pegged on the road, and they form these images. One image is U.S., and another image is the Star of David, and then another image forms a rocket, a nuclear rocket, that comes, hits the U.S. and splits it in half.
Wow.
Then hits the Star of David and splits it in half. In the Middle East, the Palestinians cry in the streets, it's the Saturday people first, that is the Jews, that is the Sabbath breakers, and it's the Sunday people next, that is America and Europe.
What they intend to do, the Jews, then the Christians are next.
That's right.
There are many people in America say, well, if we would just stop supporting Israel, they'll leave us alone. That's an absolutely false assumption. We are connected together, not
yes.
politically. We're connected together theologically.
Yes, appeasement, as Churchill said, is feeding the crocodile until I'm the last to go.
Yes, hoping he won't eat you.
Yes.
Tell our audience, what is an honor killing?
And most Americans think that honor killing is the process of a family member killing a girl if she commits adultery. This is only one perspective. There's only one part of it. Honor killing is killing anyone who dishonors either his honor, whether with sexual immorality, or his faith. So a Muslim becoming a Christian like myself is to be killed as an honor killing. So honor killing goes beyond the spectrum of killing just the girls. The first honor killing that we witnessed was going to our school. I didn't want to go see it, so my friend Elias went and saw it. And he came to school and described it to us as the father took the daughter because she was accused of adultery.
She was.
She was. She didn't really commit adultery. But he decapitated her on the doorstep of his home. And the entire community came as a witness. The Israelis, of course, arrested him, put him in jail. And the community raised a fund to bail him out. There is a difference, and that's what Americans need to understand. You are trying to compare yourselves to the Middle Eastern ways. You're trying to make a beacon of democracy in Iraq, not understanding that we think differently than you. Our source of knowledge comes from Islam. Islam is our way of life. Islam is our culture. Islam is our laws. Islam is our future. Islam is our destiny. And thank God I got out of Islam, Pastor.
So the people who are believing that Islamic people are going to come to America and become Americans are deluded. They are people who are going to come to America, who are going to continue to practice their faith, which is not just their faith. It is an ideology that's all-consuming. It's what we do, it's what we say, it's how we dress, it's where we go, it's who we love, it's who we hate. They hate us because it's a part of their faith to hate us.
Yes.
They are duty-bound by their faith to hate us.
Yes.
So there's nothing that we can do, can say, can give them, can appease them with, because they are practicing their faith when they hate us. Is that true?
Absolutely true. Every member of my family that moved to the States still is loyal to the Palestinian cause and the Palestinian people. My brother joined in the United States Air Force. He teaches his daughter to salute the flag of Palestine. And his, you know, they tell their daughter, this is not your flag, the American flag. Palestinian flag is your flag. And I had a cousin who slammed his taxi cab into a synagogue, trying to kill himself and destroy the synagogue. I have another cousin who embezzles millions of dollars from the United States and aids and abets, manufacturing false passports. If I look at my family, just my family alone, I haven't found a single one that would sympathize with what I've done. In fact, my brother called my wife, and he says, after he found out what I was doing, he says, tell your husband, we know what he's doing against Islam. Don't forget to tell him we know where he lives.
We'll be right back. You want to hear the rest of the story.
Pastor Hagee has revised and updated Jerusalem Countdown. We are on a countdown to crisis, a nuclear showdown initiated by Iran, a battle for Jerusalem, and this war will affect every person on planet Earth. As nuclear storm clouds gather over Iran and Israel, they are casting a long shadow on America and the nations of the world. This is the essence of Pastor Hagee's book, Jerusalem Countdown. And now, it has been updated to address the recent conflict with Hezbollah, the roles of North Korea and Syria in the coming nuclear showdown, and the infiltration of Islamic terrorists on American soil. Enhancing the message of the original edition, which sold more than 700,000 copies, John Hagee anticipates Israel's strategies toward the Iranian threat and the resulting effect upon America. Pastor Hagee skillfully unveils the reasons radical Islam and Israel cannot dwell peaceably together and why Christians must support the state of Israel. It's available in bookstores everywhere, or call and ask for offer B128. It's just $14.
I was a terrorist. I planted a bomb in the bank. I wanted to kill Jews. I hated them. I read the Bible in 1993 and spent a year researching it because my wife asked me, where are the corruptions in the Bible? I was going to convert her to Islam. The truth in the Bible is the best investment any man can make. And thank God I got out of Islam, Pastor.
Walid Shoebat is an ex-Muslim terrorist. His conversion to Christianity is a powerful testimony everyone should hear. As a companion resource, we also want you to have the documentary Obsession, Radical Islam's War Against the West. Obsession reveals the unbridled hatred radical Islam has for Western civilization. Pastor's interview with Walid Shoebat is available on cassette, CD, and VHS or DVD. The movie Obsession is available only on DVD. Call 1-800-854-9899. Ask for offer number KT127.
Thank you for rejoining us. My guest today is Walid Shoebat. He was born in Bethlehem. He was trained as a child in the Islamic theology to hate the Jewish people, to consider them as the offspring of monkeys, to consider them as defiled, as the source of every malady on the face of the earth. And he bought a Bible and became a Christian. And he is now traveling the world telling his story. I would like to ask this question because I have read it and I need to hear it from someone who practiced the faith. Is lying acceptable in Islam for the purpose of advancing the Islamic faith?
Yes, lying is acceptable to make peace between husband and wife, and another occasion is in jihad.
To make peace between husband and wife.
So, Pastor, you can lie to the husband, and then you can lie to the wife, say he loves you, so you can kind of get him along. This is from the small element, the minor element, but the major element is in jihad. It goes beyond that. Covenant breaking is the major issue in Islam. You're allowed to break covenant because Muhammad, the Prophet of Islam, in the Hudaybiyah treaty with Quraysh, broke the covenant, and he was critiqued by his Muslim followers, and he says there is no covenant with unbelievers. In fact, Pastor, when I confronted my father, it was the last words with my father. I purchased land from my own father, and I had the bill of sale. And I asked my father, I said, Father, I'm not interested in the inheritance. I'm not interested in your blessings. I'm simply interested in the bill of sale that we have. He says, Son, you know, in Islam, we do not have to honor agreements with unbelievers. So it doesn't matter what covenant you sign. They don't have to honor the covenant. So what's the use of having all this peace treaty? All Christians must look at the word hudna, H-U-D-N-A. Hudna in Islam is the process of establishing covenant peace treaties with an enemy, and is done for solely two purposes. One is to gain concessions, as the Palestinians did, and the other is to regain strength. This is why Hezbollah accepts this hudna. It's not the Oslo Peace Accord, as we think. It's the Oslo Hudna Accord. You look at it as the Oslo Peace Accord, but in the Middle East, we call it the Oslo Hudna Accord.
That's very interesting. That means any peace treaty they sign, they're not obligated to keep it.
Not at all.
Just an absolute waste of time to pursue it, because if they sign it, they simply are not going to honor it.
And anybody who buys it is just becoming another Chamberlain.
That's very, very interesting. I have never heard that. I have never read that. And I've done a lot of reading, but I've never, ever read that. That gives a complete clarity to a lot of things I have read. The Palestinians say that they hate the Jewish people because they occupy the land of Israel. But the hatred of the Jewish people, by the Palestinians began a long time before Israel became a state on May 15, 1948. Why is it? What is the real truth of why the Islamic people, the Palestinian people, the Hamas people, the Hezbollah people hate the Israeli people?
They hate Israeli people because of the covenant that God established in the Bible regarding that land. We must understand that the author of the Quran cannot be the same author of the Bible. The covenant is not with Ishmael. When I first read the Bible, the covenant was with Isaac, and it was an eternal covenant forever. So they want to prove that this is a fabrication, that the Bible has been fabricated by the Jews. That land has been given to the Muslims. Although the Quran itself says that the land does belong to Moses and his people, yet that was changed later on, and they want to destroy the evidence of God. This is why when the jihadists win, if we pull out, let's say, of Lebanon, if Israel pulls out of Lebanon, You see them mustering throughout the streets in demonstrations. Why? Because this proves to them that the covenant Islam gave them, that they will destroy the Jews, is true. Mm-hmm. This is why when the Mujahideen wins in Afghanistan, as the Americans helped them and gave them Stinger missiles to fight communist Russia. What happened? As soon as they won, jihad movement grew like a mushroom, like wildfire, because this to them proved that Allah is true and the jihadist God is real. In fact, Sheikh Qaradawi, the most prominent, one of the most prominent figures in the Muslim world, he says, "La tu'adu Filistinu illa bil Islam." That means we can never regain Palestine, that is Jerusalem, except by going back to Islam. We can never use secularism, we can never use socialism, we can never use communism. Only via Islam will we bring Palestine back, which will give them the confidence that their faith is true. So it's confidence build-up, if you will. In the Bible, however, we don't need this confidence build-up, because the elements of fulfillment in the Bible is tremendous. We have 8,352 verses of prophetic nature in the Bible. When I read the Word of God, the true Word of God, Pastor, I started realizing, wow, just as Isaiah said, "I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me." Foretelling the end from the beginning. You don't have this aspect in Islam. So in essence, Satan wants to kind of parallel something. Uh-huh. And as you see it fulfilled, as you see the Muslims killing the Jews, it's fulfilling a part of Islamic dogma. When you see the Antichrist even coming with 7-year covenant, do you know the Mahdi comes with a 7-year covenant peace treaty? Mm-hmm. So in essence, there is evil and there is good. There is God and there is Satan.
Tell us how you became a Christian.
Just what I am saying. I read the Bible. I was a terrorist. I planted a bomb in a bank. I wanted to kill Jews. I hated them. I was called a freedom fighter. When I changed my mind and I loved the Jewish people and I loved the Americans and I took my racism away, now I was being labeled as a racist. I read the Bible in 1993 and spent a year researching it because my wife asked me, where are the corruptions in the Bible? I was going to convert her to Islam. Because as Muslims, we believe the Jews corrupted the Bible. And as I started studying it, I ran into thousands of verses which spoke in our time. I started understanding from the Bible that we have two roadmaps. One roadmap that is set by the United Nations, and one roadmap that is set by God in the Bible. Everything was foretold. I lived in Israel. I saw our battles in several battles, whether it's the Six-Day War, whether it's the Yom Kippur War, whether it's the 1948 War, us just trying to destroy Israel so many times. When I read the Bible, I saw that I was in collision course with God. I saw that I was in collision course with the Christian theology, because Islam denies the Trinity. Islam denies the crucifixion. Islam denies the deity of Jesus. And when I read the Bible in 1 John 2:22, who is the liar? He who denies that Jesus is the Christ. He is Antichrist that denies the Father and the Son. So the essence of Antichrist, or the spirit of Antichrist, was in the Islamic dogma. When I realized I was in a collision course with the God of the Bible, I prayed to the God of the Bible. I prayed in the name of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, show me the truth. If you make this prayer, you've dialed the right number. And I dialed the right number, and he showed me all these evidences. It was overwhelming. I had to make an investment, and the Bible, it was the best investment. The Bible is the best investment. The truth in the Bible is the best investment any man can make.
Is this the Bible you bought?
Yes, sir.
It's the Bible. Let me show it to the people. This is the Bible, and you paid, what, $10 for it?
$10.
$10. And this Bible and the truth in it changed his life, and it will change your life. The people who have a Bible that's falling apart have a life that's not. You need to know what's in this book. I'd like to ask you this question. The Israelis and Hezbollah have just finished a 34-day war in Lebanon. There is now what I call a shaky ceasefire. Where do you see this conflict going?
I see Hezbollah accepting a cessation of hostilities, as Condoleezza Rice states it. Yet, as I mentioned before, that this is what Islam calls hudna. the Palestinians will sign peace treaties with Israel. That's not a problem. It is permissible to sign a peace treaty with the enemy. They are regaining strength. The United Nations clearly says that they will not disarm Hezbollah. So Hezbollah is going to continue to be armed. They will have more smarter missiles. It won't be Katyusha rockets next time. It will be missile-guided missiles that will even hit the Knesset, if you will. They are collaborating with Iran. They are an Iranian government. Israel is not at war with Hezbollah. Israel is in war with Iran. Iran is the source of the war. Iran is taking over Iraq. The Shia government there is very clear. They are pro-Iran. Iran is controlling Syria. The Alawite government there is definitely pro-Iranian revolution. So as I see it happen, Iran will take over Iraq, and eventually we see Islamic fundamentalism growing all the way to Turkey. Turkey will turn Muslim fundamentalist. This is the second largest army in NATO. When this happens, America will not be able to fight on all these fronts. America will be forced to use its nuclear missiles.
So you see a nuclear war developing because some nations in the Middle East have it. Iran is striving to get it. Do you believe that the president of Iran, Ahmadinejad, will use nuclear weapons against Israel if and when he gets them?
Absolutely. This is his goal. He made it very clearly. He said it literally. He wants to destroy Israel. And not just Ahmadinejad is the problem, but also a country like Pakistan. Musharraf, I know he's an ally of the United States, but he plays in both parts of the fence, of course. If he's ousted out, they already have a nuclear. So it is much bigger than what Americans think. It's not just a war in Iraq. It's a war in Iraq, a war in Iran, a war in Sudan, a war potentially in Pakistan and potentially in Turkey.
This is a war that the American people do not see. This is a war that Walid sees coming, and all America must see it. I thank you for watching the telecast. Thank you for being a part of this, and Walid, thank you. God bless you. Thank you for coming.
I was a terrorist. I planted a bomb in the bank. I wanted to kill Jews. I hated them. I read the Bible in 1993 and spent a year researching it because my wife asked me, where are the corruptions in the Bible? I was going to convert her to Islam. The truth in the Bible is the best investment any man can make. And thank God I got out of Islam, Pastor.
Walid Shoebat is an ex-Muslim terrorist. His conversion to Christianity is a powerful testimony everyone should hear. As a companion resource, we also want you to have the documentary Obsession, Radical Islam's War Against the West. Obsession reveals the unbridled hatred radical Islam has for Western civilization. Pastor's interview with Walid Shoebat is available on cassette, CD, and VHS or DVD. The movie Obsession is available only on DVD. Call 1-800-854-9899. Ask for offer number KT-127.